local civic leaders, War College faculty, staff, students and families, and last but not least, members of the Tailhook Association. Welcome to the 1992 edition of the Naval War College Put a Lid on It Follies. What you will see, hear, and sometimes feel tonight is not necessarily the view of the Department of the Navy, the Naval War College, its faculty, or staff, but it is specifically the view of the War College students and their families. Let me introduce your Master of Ceremonies for tonight, a student in the College of Naval Command and Staff who hopes her association with this irreverent event won't affect her hopes of graduating next week. Ladies and gentlemen, Lieutenant Commander Miriam Pearlberg, United States Navy.
Good evening, and welcome back to Spruance Auditorium. As is always the case here in Spruance, I think you'll find that tonight's speakers will be quite candid with you. To protect them, and in keeping with the time-honored War College tradition, what you see here tonight is not for attribution to the speakers. Joining me with the play-by-play on tonight's festivities is a classmate in the College of Naval Command and Staff, Lieutenant Commander John Green. John will be walking throughout the audience tonight. He'll be gauging your reactions, offer some scathing analysis, conduct impromptu interviews, and he'll ensure that there's no sleeping in Spruance this evening. Our first presentation this evening is from the Army officers of the College of Naval Warfare. Strategy and policy made quite an impression on them, and their presentation starts by taking you back just a few years in time. Our fun night of Follies begins the first half with a unique and interesting skit from the Army senior class. Now, history is not our favorite topic. We've suffered through S&P, listening to countless lectures from Handel and Baer, Fuller and Lee. We begged for lectures to stop. We begged to go to the bar. Our only sympathy came from Professor Ross. Relax and have a cigar. Now it's time to strike back. It's time to shake the roof. What the War College needs is nothing but the truth. Now we'll take you back in time when the world was at war. Hitler was kicking ass. We needed to settle the score. We take you now to Tehran, to the strategic level of war. The overlord invasion is the subject discussed by a group of four. President Roosevelt is ready for dinner. Churchill the host to his other right. Uncle Joe Stalin is ready for action. General Ike has arrived for the night. Relationships between interests and goals have now reached a junction. Let's take a real sober look at how alliances really function. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Tehran 1943.
In January was historic. We decided to go for unconditional German surrender, much against my better judgment.
I'm sorry, I'm just a simple soldier from Kansas.
It's the first time the three of us, Mr. Stalin, the three of us have been here, and I propose a toast.
Indeed.
To this august gathering.
A toast.
Toast.
What's that? $5 an hour. Mm. Master Retailer?
Well, you look well, Sir Winston. It's good to see that Hitler hasn't knocked out all of London's food stores. Closest thing I've seen to two fronts, though, is where I'm sitting right now in this war.
Now, Joel, let's not get on that two-front business again. You know, we've been fighting in Japan for well over 2 years. And don't forget the Chinese. After all, the Chinese have taken a great deal of heat off of your backside. I would even go so far as to say that the American industrialization has helped open up a front for you. Good salad.
You call that a second front?
Indeed, I do, yes.
I mean, who does Japan threaten anyway, you know?
Gentlemen, we must rise above these personal differences. I insist we return to our theme. How?
How indeed?
Are we going to open a new front for our thrust through the Balkans from the River Po? We must use our maritime strength.
There they go again, Joe.
Corbett. Who are you?
Joe, those British are nice guys, but they're just too much like naval strategists. You know, a little bit of Mahan here, a little bit of Corbett there, and too much of Strasse everywhere.
There it is. Real navalists they are. Mm.
Could we have the main course, please, waiter? More wine.
I never ordered spaghetti.
More wine. You'll like it, Winston. You'll like it.
This is absolutely disgusting.
Come on. Yes.
He's fine with it, okay? You're right on mine.
I can't stand this American food. This is terrible.
Thank you. This is Strasse. Why in the hell don't I have a name tag? All these other people have a name tag.
Hey, no, also,
carry on.
Yes, thank you. We all know who you are. Now, Mr. Stalin. Mr. Stalin. Are you listening? Mr. Stalin. I have to tell you that you would be nowhere, without the support of the Russian convoys to the mat. Supported by my gallant Royal Navy.
Nowhere is where you are right now while we're on the continent fighting a real war.
Now, gentlemen, let me return to my main theme. When this war is over, I really must insist on free determination for the Poles. Free determination for the Poles. We went to war for them in the first place. I have to say that I accepted the Curzon line that you proposed back in 1941, and I'm really not prepared to allow East Prussia to be absorbed into your Russia.
Now, let's not get divisive here. Let's be decisive.
Oh, God.
You know, we're all concerned about where this war is going to go, but we know that wherever it goes, we're going to win it. And, of course, I think the key to winning it is a total unity of effort. And I think in that unity of effort, we need a key leader. a leader like the dignified gentleman here on the left of the table. Ike. A gentleman fully trained. I say fully trained in TQC. TQC, Total Quality Coalition.
I'm just so happy to be here.
I think he's our man.
What are you talking about? What are you talking about? In Britain, I have battle-hardened leaders from the desert. Your people are only any good at war gaming.
You call that fighting? All they face has been Italian. The real war heroes are... The real war heroes are in the Eastern Front where we're fighting.
Thank you. Take care of those guys.
Yeah, and the best of them, Mr. Roosevelt, the best of them. The best of them died in 1939.
Indeed they did. Indeed they did. Hey, Joe, do you have a problem with your arms? I know I got problems with my lower extremities, but God sakes.
Hey, this is where I get close in parking.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, Cross.
I'm so happy to be here.
Who are you?
Give me your partner right there, Roosevelt.
Why am I sitting next to this badly dressed?
Well, let me address that. I think it's very important that four of us here are just sitting here at the table tonight. Because we must be concerned not only about this war, but after the end of the war, indeed, how the world looks. And it's going to take four players to make that world work, and I think China is the fourth player that can make it work. In the great words of Sun Tzu...
Who?
In the great words of Sun Tzu, yeah.
Well, I don't know why you're talking about foreplay, but anyway, who's this? Some deadly Oriental, another one of your enemies that you've dreamed up?
Clausewitz,
that famed Russian would tell you. Who's on a real front? Says here in Europe.
Well, gentlemen, I think we are about to reach a historic conclusion. A new understanding will be reached. Here in
who are you?
Here in Tehran.
I'm so happy to be here.
But we really must, and I insist on this point, agree to reasonable terms for Germany once we bomb them to pieces.
Huh, at the rate you're going, you'll have to call me to find out how the war came out.
Gentlemen, as I was saying before, I think it's very important that we get back to the leadership. And the unity, I say again, the unity of effort here. There's a place in Georgia you can go. As a matter of fact, the unity of effort is most important. As a matter of fact, that's why Ike is here tonight. Because that leadership ability that he's exhibited in war game after war game is just the guy we need. Dessert?
Dessert.
Oh, very well, thank you. We'll have dessert.
Oh, is this American as well?
No, I think this is British. It's soft and kind of mushy.
Oh, boy. This looks good.
Yes.
I am not real happy to be here now.
Do we have a power failure there, Winston? Is there a power failure? Gentlemen, please. I think that Eisenhower, perhaps it's time for Eisenhower to tell us how he plans to lead this effort.
It was time 12 years ago, but anyway, I have brought a briefing with me. It's called the Handel's Theory of War Termination. Show him the chart, Gizmo.
Relax. Pay no attention to those noisy Islamic fundamentalists here in Tehran.
Okay.
Remember, our War College professor, Ms. Milroy, she said there's no threat from Islamic fundamentalists.
Never will be.
Hear, hear.
You know, Miriam, after watching that skit, it makes me question the Army's claim that they send their best people here. I want to break in here in just a second. I noticed the chaplain and his wife just came in a little late. I'd like to seat them. We have the senior chaplain at the Chapel of Hope and his wife. Could you come with me, please, sir, right down here? I wanted everyone in the audience to know that the senior chaplain at the Chapel of Hope was here tonight. Can you, sir, right, yes, ma'am, right here. Right. Make yourself at home. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you. You know, after watching that, I understand why it's so important that we get the Army out of Europe as soon as possible.
Yeah, they certainly did put a new twist on the implications of alliances in the international security picture. But you know, John, that's supposed to be one of the great benefits of being here at the War College.
Yeah.
It's a year to sit back, to be an armchair quarterback, to review history, to look at current events, major policy decisions. Last year's class must have had a heck of a good time playing with Operation Desert Storm.
Yeah, I bet. You know, who can forget this year, the coup in the former Soviet Union, or whatever they're calling it today?
Well, yeah, I'm sure that was a real big deal for the Soviets, but we missed the coup here in Newport. Hurricane Bob blew through the same day.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, by the time I got power back, the whole Soviet Union had already dissolved.
We'll probably read about it.
Yeah, somewhere along the line. Well, you know, this is a Navy War College, and it wouldn't be right for us not to have a skit from the Navy. Guy Smiley. Come on down.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the next part of our show. Oh. Let me have that sound man fix me up here for a second.
Come
on,
Mr.
Smiley. I hate when that happens. Get out of here. I'll see you after the show. I love that sound man. Well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Wasn't that Army skit great? And that food fight, best I've seen in a long time. But I want to welcome you now to our second part of our show, and my name is Guy Smiley, I'm your host, and this is the New England Association of Higher Education, Newport edition of the Masters. Now let's meet our three contestants, but before we do that, we tried to get some volunteers, but unfortunately most of the students here at the Naval War College know what the term Navy stands for, and that stands for Never Again Volunteer Yourself, N-A-V-Y. So we've used the total quality leadership techniques we've learned here at the War College, and we've forced a group of people to be our contestants tonight. Now let's meet team number one, coming to us from the famous Severn Heights Institute of Technology. We call them the Academics. Come on down, Academics. Let's hear it for them. Here they come. Team number two, you won't get a straight answer out of team number two, coming to us direct from the Armed Forces Staff College, the Joint Military Strategists. Where are they? Come on down, Joint Military Strategists. Or you can call them the Jit Twits, we call them. Now, team number three has already been here at the Naval War College for 2 years on athletic scholarship. And they're hoping to graduate perhaps next week. Come on down, let's see where the jocks at. Come on down, jocks. Here they come. Hey, while our team members are getting here, let's take a minute and meet our three noble contestants. Team number one.
Thank you, Gee. I'm Captain Max Footnote, Surface Nukes.
And I'm Commander Wes Brake, Nuke Sub.
What an exciting couple. How about team number two?
Hey, Guy, Commander Roger Ramjet, my wingman, Roger, and neither one of us were a tailhook.
And team number three, where are you from and who are you?
Hey, Captain Double Bogey Bob here, and my threesome consists of flag crack and pedal pusher.
Whoa. Super. Now, you three teams, ladies and gentlemen, these three teams, can't you guys read? These three teams. Thank you. These three teams will be tasked with coming up with some impossible list of items to ensure their graduation. I mean, for the contest, they'll come up with a great list of items. They'll have to come up with a joke book, the unasked question of the graduating class. They'll have to find the preeminent military strategist in the area. They'll have to come up with
a useful map, a stupid paper topic, which there are plenty here at the work hours. They'll also have to discover who was the test gougemeister. As you can see, our Navy budget's been cut. We're not up on the special effects, but they'll also have to come up with a cartoon from the bulletin board. They'll have to select their favorite elective. They'll also have to determine the military lecture of opportunity, the ultimate war game scenario, and finally, we'll ask them a survey question. Why do they want to come here to the Naval War College? Are there any questions, team?
Hey, Guy, my man.
No problem for us. We'll get in 9 holes and be back in time for happy hour.
Yeah. Super. I get it. This is crazy. And he's going.
Say, Gay, this isn't going to take very long, is it?
No.
We're in between tutorials.
Not long at all.
Relax, have a cigar.
Right, well then off you go.
Wait, where's the con plan for this? Commander's estimate.
You guys gotta be kidding me. Get out of here.
Hey, guys, do we get like travel orders or per diem?
You guys C3 pilots? Hit the road. While our teams are out gathering their memorabilia for our contest tonight, we'll hear a word from the Newport home of the mentally deranged, from the Naval War College, our sponsor.
Thanks, Steve. Good evening. My name is Thaddeus P. Worthington III from the Naval War College Foundation. It has come to the attention of several members of our board that there is a general misunderstanding of the mission and daily operations of our beloved institution of higher learning, the Naval War College. Therefore, members of my staff have assembled a quick informative brief to clear up any misconceptions the taxpaying public may have. We are extremely proud of each and every one of our students and faculty and hope to remain on the cutting edge of the academic world. This distinguished institution is staffed with a highly intellectual faculty with a very impressive background. All academic departments constantly reshape their curriculum to optimize educational efficiency, as top officials from the operations department recently streamlined their wonderful program. Most instruction is conducted in seminars where the professors encourage frank and open discussion. Instructors all tediously prepare for lectures and seminars even while they commute to the college, like the head of the strategy and policy department, Professor Fuller. The classes are especially blessed this year with a high level of student professional experience from an abundance of Desert Storm heroes. Joint education is the cornerstone of the school, with several lessons covering air-land battle, including Army Special Forces. Marine Corps officers, as part of the Navy team, have found the step-by-step curriculum and facilities well within their mental capacity. Curriculum is vital, and currency is maintained with an intricate worldwide intelligence network. The War College was recently permitted to award a master's degree. The rigorous standards of the outstanding New England Accreditation Board are backed with a solid understanding of democratic principles. This recent accreditation, however, has not raised the academic standards beyond the average student's knowledge level. The workload is minimal, with light weekly reading required. To be awarded a master's degree, students must maintain a B-minus average, which is easily taken in stride by most students. Those individuals
those individuals who apply themselves enjoy the curriculum tremendously and maintain a healthy mental attitude. Speaking of healthy mental attitude, I've been asked to mention a product endorsed by one of our War College staff members. Now, when Clausewitz begins to make sense, when Bismarck starts to look like a fun guy, when Ops seems to have a sense of direction, when Sun Tzu's tactics affect your approach to a Power Five, and you've reached your culminating point of studying, the right strategy is to reach for a Strasser's Strode. It's brewed exclusively with sparkling water from Narragansett Bay. It was a very good week. Its clean, fresh taste will definitely quell those midterm jitters. So when the academic pencil necks get you down, reach for a Strasser's. You won't want to keep a lid on this one. The Naval War College does, back to our original program, the Naval War College does maintain academic standings. However, by and large, these standards are ignored with the exception of a few Army and Air Force officers. If problems or questions should arise concerning grades on papers or tests, an appeal may be made to an academic review process with no fear of retribution if you review your grades. It's true. Nothing will happen to you. Why do you question? Okay. To provide a well-rounded education, the curriculum is supplemented by an evening lecture series, often featuring top political leaders and their closest military advisors. These lectures are fascinating and hold our students spellbound. To show it's not all work and no play, the president of the Naval War College, Admiral Strasser, set the social standards with his relaxed and informal reception. To promote an aggressive, take-the-initiative combat attitude, the college promotes athletic competition. Physical readiness tests are also administered every 6 months to maintain our future leaders in tip-top condition. In summation, we feel the War College is at the pinnacle of military education. This institution of higher learning, with its superb civilian and military faculty, prepares our future flag officers for the toughest of challenges that lie ahead. Especially now, with the awarding of a versatile master's degree, not only will our graduates be prepared for a successful military career, but also lucrative civilian positions. Thanks for your support.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, Strasser's Strode, and there will actually be a limited quantity available in the lobby during intermission, so make sure you get yours right away. Hey, it looks as if our contestants are back in record time. Let's hear a big round of applause for them and see what they've come up with. All right, well, let's get right to it. The first item you were supposed to try and locate was a joke book. How about you, Roger?
We came up with the Andrew Dice Clay Encyclopedia of Truly Offensive Jokes.
That's a beautiful thing. How about you, Bob?
Hey, we were able to come up with only one sheet. Hey, it says, what's this? Jokes for Flag and General Officers.
That's a pretty well-used line there about Air Force uniforms.
And how about you, Max and Les?
Well, we have this interesting pamphlet, 101 Illustrated Unlit Cigar Jokes.
No, look. It goes like this. See, Ross's name is at the top.
Fascinating. How about the number one unasked question from the graduating class? Bob and Renee Bob?
Hey, well, we thought hard about this one, and we came up with, does anybody ever read those elective papers?
Hey, who cares? How about you, Max and Les?
Yeah, Gomer, a big question in our minds was, who thought of having an ethics symposium in Rhode Island?
only the war college. Only the war college can come up with that. Roger, what did you come up with?
Well, obviously the best one was, which naval aviator is going to fill the Ted Kennedy chair of sexual harassment?
You.
We weren't there.
Well, those are fascinating answers. And our next category was finding the preeminent military strategist in the area. Let's start with team number three, the jocks. Who did you find?
Well, we picked the guy that we've known for the last year who's taught us the absolute most about military strategy. Sven, the marina manager.
Welcome, Sven, the marina.
Best strategy I can give you is keep your damn sailboats off my dock. And you call yourself naval officers? Where did you learn rules of roads, SWAS?
That's MWR for you. Okay, how about team number two, Roger.
Well, we went to the man himself, St. Alfred of Newport, Admiral Mahan.
Ding, 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 ding. War College arriving.
Why don't you just tell me about this crazy Julian Corbett fella? He's always preoccupied with his command of the sea or sea control bullshit.
It all comes down to COCOM. No problem.
Hey, Max, who are you guys able to dig up?
Well, we went for the school solution, or the school source, Clausewitz. Carla Clausewitz.
That doesn't look like Carl.
Everyone's always looking for Carl. Well, I wrote the book and put my name on it instead of his. You know, he's always in a fog of something super. The only trilogy he knew was little beer on a stinky cigar.
Get your bag out of here. Get out of here. Well, moving right along, ladies and gentlemen, our next topic.
Keep going and going.
Who knows? Okay, the next topic was the useful map category. And let's start with Max and Les.
Well, our favorite was the Civil War Railroad map.
Ah.
Hey, help me plan my vacation.
Where's the city?
Yeah, great for the vacation thing. And how about Roger?
Well, after we looked around, the most useful map we could come up with was unmarked one-way streets between Fort Adams and the War College.
Clear as mud. And how about Bob and the jocks?
Well, how about the one, the map to the Newport Country Club?
Hey, wait a minute. How did you get to play Newport without having to mow the lawn?
Well, it comes down to our favorite course was
Green
this
Valley.
Course.
Yes.
Not.
It was Green Valley.
Oh. Okay, let's go on to the stupid paper topic. Max and Les, you look like a couple of stupid guys. What was your topic?
Well, I drew this topic for my S&P paper. It's entitled, and I parlayed it into a B+, as a matter of fact. I thought it was a superhuman effort.
Good man.
Robust deterrence and supportive interoperability paradoxical to today's constructive paradigm.
Ooh, and you notice he used the
keyword. Ramjet. How about you, Roger Ramjet? What did you come up with for your paper?
Had to be coastal defense and blimp, naval infantry. Made no sense to us.
Is that the Navy with or without the Marines?
Well, don't have to worry about the Marines and blimps. They're going to get V-22s.
And rubber pedals, who did you guys come up with?
Well, Guy, my man, it's come down to the effects of the environment on sporting events, rain delays, and the shotgun start.
Best part of it was I got full credit for an ARP to the Arnold Schwarzenegger Chair of Physical Fitness. Pedals has it right here. Full copy.
Now, our next topic was the Cass Gougemeister. Roger, how about you two?
We always use Colonel John Brown, U.S. Army.
And Bob and the Jocks, what do you find?
Hey, gotta be the best. It's got to be the best.
Yeah, best man, best info.
Sure, best info on free food, good music, happy hours, bartender at the Double Tree.
You're supposed to find a test gouge master,
hey,
you guys.
Test, best. Come on, we've never taken
it. How about less than math?
We don't understand gouge. We don't need no stinking gouge.
Hey, man, we don't need gouge. We have black badges.
Well, let me see. Okay. What did you guys come up with the best cartoon from the bulletin board? Which cartoon was it? Number three,
hey,
they dropped.
Hey, that cartoon.
That's our cartoon.
That's ours.
Hey, come on. So we plagiarized. Give me a break.
All right, all right.
Let me get a B.
Let's move on. How about the favorite elective class? How about Roger and the Ramjet? What do you guys
had
find?
Had to be SC-801. Bismarck's early career highlights his early years, his serve as a lieutenant, and it provides useful insight into his drinking problem.
Yeah, useful. And how about Max and Les?
Thanks, Gomer. We like the introduction to Clausewitz's influence on Sun Tzu, particularly the requirements.
And don't forget, you need to understand German to handle teaching.
Sieg Heil!
And how about Bob and the Drohawk?
Well, PE-801, golf in the 21st century.
At least if you don't guess the lecture, really helped my swing.
Yeah, it looks like it did pretty good for double bogey Bob. Ooh, it's in the hole.
How about the lecture of opportunity? Bob, let's go back to you and your group. What did you guys come up with?
I think that was Colonel Paul Nell on how to get in 36 holes a day and still teach full-time in the ops department.
He said operations a full-time job.
I don't know.
Not me. Max or Les?
Our most enlightening lecture was General McPeak on the ups and downs of space available travel.
was that single seat?
That's right, single seat, space A.
Good answer. And how about Bob and the Ramjet? I mean,
well, we wouldn't want to miss the Admiral Dunleavy lecture on equal opportunity in naval aviation.
He's the expert on that topic, that's for sure. Now, our second to last category, it's very tight competition, I can tell by the audience reaction. What was the ultimate war game scenario that you found? How about team number two, the Ramjet team?
Had to be a trench warfare. NETC public works.
Yeah.
And how about Max Orla?
Yeah, we like the Serbian revolt. War College faculty opposes involuntary retirement.
And I think I have us in the lead there, bud.
Let's talk to the Jocks.
Well, Guy, we decided on Clausewitz's abstract on absolute war.
Yeah. Tail hookers versus Dakowitz.
Can't get any more vicious than that. All right, now we're into a tiebreaker, because I think we've all come up with an equal 88 score.
Yeah.
The tiebreaker was
best break yet.
The question of why did you want to come to the Naval War College in Newport, Rhode Island? Let's start off with bad luck.
Well, you can laugh at the Rizvik scandal and keep your money in an out-of-state bank.
Well, you can laugh at the ethics scandal and you don't have to vote for the convicts.
And Roger.
You can cause an international incident and you don't have to leave the state.
Roger squared.
Well, I think the parking is better here than at the Pentagon.
And Bob.
Well, as hard as it may be to believe, the green fees are cheaper here than at Augusta.
Yep. Pedals.
It's selling it half bad. Couldn't pass up the athletic scholarship.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, now it's time for your vote. And yes, you, the studio audience, will select the winner of tonight's grand prize. I'll put my hand over each of the teams and Lee will respond with your feverish applause. Team number one, the academic. Team number two, the joint military strategist. And team number three, the judge. Well, it's very difficult to determine the winner, but I think from your applause that our third place team is going to be the Joint Military Strategists.
Yeah.
Well, and their prize will be a all-expense-paid vacation to the Pentagon.
Ooh.
I'm sure they're excited about it. Now, going down to our runner-up and our first place team, this is very important because should the winners not be able to fulfill their requirements, the runners-up will have to substitute and take on that first prize. Our runner-up is the academic. Congratulations, congratulations. Good try, fellas. And you'll be going to beautiful Omaha as members of STRATCOM. Welcome to the Mutual of Omaha Wild Kingdom. That means you guys are the winners. And you will win the ultimate grand prize. You've been here, 2 years on athletic scholarship? You'll be remaining 3 more years. but as instructor. Yes. Congratulations.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Good night, and I hope you enjoy the Follies.
You know, Miriam, that skit reminds me of a lot of the big dog rotary speeches we've had this year. A lot of flash, but very little substance.
The circus this year.
You know, one of the participants in that skit, though, is probably the best speaker that we've seen this year. We like to call him Mr. Question, Kevin Winsing. Could you come out, Kevin? Yeah, come on down over here, Kevin, to the right. No, off the stage, Kevin. Off the stage, yeah. Thank you. Appreciate it. Actually, what we'd like to do for you, Kevin, is ask you a couple of questions tonight. First of all, we'd like to know how it is and what special training you had that allowed you to take a simple question and turn it into a 15-minute speech. And the second question we had for you, a follow-up, if I might, have you been on Rogaine for 1 year or 2 years? Okay. There you go. Thank you, Kevin. What's up next, Miriam?
Well, up next, we've got the Air Force.
And now it's time for War College, the game where we pick the school solutions and you try to guess the questions. Let's meet today's contestants. First, from Albany, Georgia, an Army National Guardsman with the 48th Roundout Brigade, just completing preparations to deploy to Operation Desert Storm, Lieutenant Colonel Bob Gruntman. Next, from Provincetown, Massachusetts, where he is on leave awaiting orders to command the 2nd, no, 3rd, the 4th Seawolf Submarine, Commander Lars Squidneck. Third, originally from San Francisco, home of the Niners, now undergoing KCB 22 conversion training with JVX Nippon of Houston, Texas, Major Lance Jarnett. And finally, representing the Naval Command College and temporarily employed as a driving instructor while waiting for the August class, Jean-Philippe Beldar. And now, ladies and gentlemen, just back from working the gauntlet room at the Las Vegas Hilton, please welcome your War College host, Alex Poopdick.
Thank you, Don. Thank you, Don. Gotta love those Hooters. Okay, let's get on with the tour. If you're all familiar with War College, you know that each contestant starts out with an 84. If he does absolutely nothing, he'll finish with an 88. But if he'd like to improve his score, he can do that by correctly giving the questions to our school solutions. Today's categories are strategy and policy, cowboys and Indians, operations, slurs and insults. Lars, as the host service, you've got the board.
Okay, cowboys and Indians for 3, please.
Cowboys and Indians for 3 it is. The answer is a Squidneck. Lars, you got it.
What is the main body part between the head and the tentacles?
Oh, that's incorrect, Lars. Anyone else? Ah.
What is the ancient Rhode Island Indian word for pothole?
Good answer. That's correct, Bob. Okay, Bob. That puts you at an 87, and you control the board.
I like slurs and insults for 7.
Slurs and insults for seven. Whoa, this is our first of our video answers that are scattered throughout the board. If you'd take a look, here's the video clue. Bob?
What are parallel lines?
That's very insightful, Bob, but incorrect. Anyone else? Lance, I think you got it.
Yes. What is the list of those admitting to attending tailhooks?
That's correct. Good answer. Okay. Lance, that brings you right up to a 91, and your choice.
Alex, I'd like S&P for two, please.
S&P for two it is. And the answer is Johnny Carson, Professor Milroy, and Professor McGargy. Lars.
What are three comedians you go to sleep with?
That's correct. Good answer, Lars. Good answer. Okay, Lars, that's an 86 for you and your choice.
I'll try S&P for six, Alex.
S&P for six it is. The answer, Foghorn Leghorn, Porky Pig, and Professor Fuller. Professor Fuller. Bob?
Wasn't me.
Will anyone admit to that? Oh, I'm sorry, contestants. The time is up. The answer is, who are the lifetime members of the Department of Redundancy Department? Lars, I think you're still on the board.
Slurs and insults for four, please.
Slurs and insults for four it is. The answer? Sir Michael Howard, Lord Nelson, 9 to 5, the best little whorehouse in Texas, and Dolly Parton. Bob.
What are a great pair of Brits, a great pair of hits, and a great pair of...
You gotta love those Hooters, ladies and gentlemen, and that was the board. That was the buzzer man, the first trimester of War College. We'll be right back right after this commercial break.
To the second trimester of War College and your host, Alex Hoopdeck.
Okay, thank you, Don. Hey, before we get started on our second trimester of War College, what do you say we meet our contestants? Beldar. That's quite an interesting...
Stop that. We're not on cruise yet.
Who? How about telling us a little bit about yourself, Beldar? I hear you're an NCC student. What is your native country?
Beldar, France.
Okay, thank you, Beldar. How about you, Bob?
Well, you know, us people in the Army, we got a lot of decorations. You know, I picked this one up here for training in Vietnam, and this one here is training for Grenada, and this one here is training for just because. You know, training's been my life.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, training's been very, very good to me. In fact, I got this one over here.
Okay, thank you, Bob. Thank you. That's nice. Lars, how about yourself?
I'm a submariner now, but I used to be a naval aviator and a project officer for the A-12. After that program was axed last year, I took over as the affirmative action officer for the Tailhook Association. That job fell through, too. So now I switched to the submarine career field. Attached to Commander Helen White. the Seawolf program coordinator.
Mm-hmm.
They told me that after Tailhook, that if I expected a future in the Navy, I should go to Helen Wake.
Okay. Thank you, Lars. Lance, how about yourself?
Well, Alec, you know I'm a Capricorn.
Uh-huh.
No, it's true. And I was born in San Francisco, and I was born in January 1969. It was a good year. It was a really good year. Well, I went to an all-boys school in Maryland, and I like muscle magazines, and I love gladiator movies, and I love Turkish baths. And of course, Alex, I don't know if you know, but I play football.
Oh, really? What position did you play?
Well, I used to be a tight end, but now I'm a wide receiver.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Lars. That's fascinating. Well, how about we get back to the second trimester of the War College? Beldar, I believe you've got to control the board.
Ops for one.
The answer is PQL, sexual harassment training, and security awareness. Bob, I think you got it again.
What are the three greatest threats in the new defense planning guidance?
Fascinating answer, Bob. But incorrect. Anyone else? Beldar, down at the end.
Well, there's air service and naval service.
Excuse me, Beldar, your answer must be in the form of a question.
Oh, sorry. What is lip service?
That's correct, Beldar. Good answer. Okay, you're up to an 85. You're up to an 85, Beldar, and you've got the board.
Ops for six,
the answer is Marilyn Monroe, Pabst Blue Ribbon Beer, and Admiral Charles R. Larson. Bob, you've got it again.
What are a sex pot, a six pack, and a think pack?
Yeah, that's good. That's correct, Bob. Good answer. 92. You're leading now, and what do you go with?
I'll take slurs and insults for eight.
Slurs and insults for eight. The answer is, the second of our video answers. Don, why don't you show us that answer? There it is, contestant. Bob?
Who is Jim Fix?
I'm sorry, that's incorrect. Anyone else? Lars, how about you? Contestant, you're absolutely right. Who cares? Let's move on with the game. Oh, I'm sorry. There's the buzzer. It ends round two of the War College. Round three is the final exam answer during War College, where the contestants will wager part or all of their score on the final exam answer. The final exam category is National Security Decision Making. And the answer to the question is O'Brien's Pub, the Islander Doubletree Inn, and In Your Dreams. But as they fill in their wagers, we'll take this commercial break and be right back.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, back to Alec.
Okay, welcome back to War College. It's now time for the final examination round of War College. Each player has already wagered part or all of his score on the final. Remember, the answer is O'Brien's Pub, the Islander Double Tree Inn, and In Your Dream. Bob, your quiz. What are the three most popular places for downtown NSDM seminars? That's incorrect. You wagered a 9. That leaves you with an 84. Good solid B. Lars, how about yourself? Where were the 06 wedding gown parties for the Air Force, the Navy, and the Army? That's correct. Good answer. You wagered a 5. That gives you a 91. You've got the lead right now. Lance, how about yourself? Oh, same answer. The 06 wedding gown parties, Air Force, Navy, and the Army. Excellent response, you wagered. A 6, whoa, that gives you a 97. You're taking the lead, Lance. Oh, easy, Lance, easy. Okay, let's move on to... Let's move on to Belgar now. Wait a minute. Well, could I have Lance's answer back, please? Oh, Lance. I'm sorry. You forgot the footnote. Oh, you're disqualified. I'm sorry about that. Okay, on to Beldar. Beldar, your answer? I have no idea. I missed NSDM classes while I was in Seattle and Walt Disney World. I'm sorry, Beldar, that's incorrect. Beldar wagered a 10. That brings you down to a 75. Well, that's a C plus, but you get no parting master's degree, I'm afraid. Yeah. Oh, Beldar.
Yes, Beldar. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, Beldar just informed me that NCC students do not have to take final examinations. In that case, Beldar, you are our grand prize winner with an N98. You are the 1992 honor graduate of the War College. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a pleasure.
Today's contestants take home a home version of the War College, a box of Sherlock medicated cigars, a gross of Trojan computer shields, and a copy of Professor McGargy's new book, Testimonials, a collection of slurs and insults through the ages. We'll be right back with the next act by the Marine Juniors, known as Here's Joni. But first, this public service message.
It's such a pretty day. There's Narragansett Bay, and who could forget the Newport Bridge? Gosh, what a beautiful view. This has been a really great year. Salem has been great. There's the boat club. Oh, look. Admiral Strasser. Oh, gosh. Are you all right, sir?
Henry. Henry. How you doing, Henry?
Oh, I'm fine, sir. Are you all right?
Yeah, no. What did you holler at me for, Henry?
Well, your shoelace is untied, sir.
Well, thanks a lot, Henry.
No problem.
Hey, while I have you here, Henry, being physically fit is really important here at the Naval War College, and we want to emphasize jogging and physical fitness. But you know, I had an accident this last winter that really struck my attention about the necessity for protective equipment with the helmet and the mask. You know, I got a pretty good raspberry on me here.
Yeah, you look pretty protected now.
Yeah, well, I am. You know, the missus told me that I needed to start taking care of myself. But I have the vest on because I'm running close to the water now. Saturday, there's going to be the Admiral's Cup 10K race. And you know what? We're going to have the protective helmets and the mask for the runners to go ahead and check out. Just in case, as they're running around base, you know, they happen to trip or fall or meet some demise along the course.
But will they need the life preservers there?
No, they won't have to check out the life preservers because they won't be running by the water. But I think, I haven't had any film put in my photographic memory lately, but I think that they'll just have to check out the helmet and the mask. Now Henry, thanks for helping me out here. Whatever you do, Henry, if you would, kind of keep a lid on this, will you?
Yes, sir.
Thanks, Henry.
Will do. Bye, sir. Wow.
I tell you, John, I've got to hand it to the Air Force. They always come up with one of those high-tech kind of productions. You know, you'd think that with all of us dressed in civilian clothes in class, you wouldn't be able to identify people by service, but you always can.
Yeah, that's true.
As soon as we start all those little in-class exercises, you know, little group things, you can always tell. The Navy guys always want to wing it. The Army and the Marines always want to use maps, flip charts, and pointers that turn into pens, and the Air Force always goes multimedia. Looks like we're ready for our next batch, and it'll be from the Marines of the junior class.
Existence and more.
You got the answers to the ops questions?
No, don't have those.
Oh.
Nobody does. These envelopes were hermetically sealed in a jar of mayonnaise since noon yesterday. For maximum security, that jar was surgically attached to the senior Marine, Colonel J.J. Doyle, until moments ago.
Must have hurt.
Colonel Doyle, thanks for being a team player, sir. Appreciate it. No one, I say again, no one has seen the contents, and now you, O Seminar Enchantress, can provide the answers to that which confounds us the most. The security of these envelopes can be verified by the highest authority.
Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Please, the envelope, sweepstakes man.
There you go, O Amphibiousness.
Rap, Crystal Pepsi, and TQL.
Rap, Crystal Pepsi, TQL.
Big chunk. What historians will consider passing fancies of the 1990s.
Next,
I think we
one.
Got an 85 on that one. Basic instinct.
Basic instinct.
There's an echo here.
I get big bucks for this.
Not enough.
Sometimes.
What mysterious force accounts for all the empty cubicles at the Naval War College on Friday?
We're getting better.
Two to go.
Unaccompanied tours, a dental appointment, and no pay due.
Unaccompanied tours, a dental appointment, and no pay due.
The only event as painful as an unscheduled afternoon lecture.
Make it a goodie.
Roster.
Roster.
What could this be?
You have the answers.
What is the list of all the seniors with security violations?
The last one, oh, amphibious miss.
The best for last.
The best for last. Quiet.
Hey. Silence of the lambs.
Silence of the lambs.
What is the slogan for the members of the 1991 Cowork Association?
Well, what do we got for a show?
Well, E.D., what we have tonight is some special guests who are going to join us. Of course, we all remember the very beginning of S&P when we got to hear all the classifications and all the qualifications of all the fine instructors at the Naval War College. So tonight, we have a special guest. We have Professor Omni Bustis, who's a professor at the Naval War College.
Good.
Additionally, we have Admiral Strouser, who will be joining us tonight. So let's get started with our first guest. Professor Omni Bustis is a chair professor of anthropologic economic security affairs at the United States Naval War College. He's valedictorian graduate of Yale, has a master's magnum cum laude from the prestigious Harvard Kennedy School of Government, a PhD
emeritus
from Perth School of Diplomacy. Dr. Omni Bustis is a leading authority and prime researcher in his unique and specialized fields of ancient Neanderthal commerce activity and defense habits with a subspecialization in Grecian air power during the Peloponnesian War. He's held several very important and private governmental advisory positions throughout his entire career. Among these was the economic and security consultant for Mikhail Gorbachev from 1981 to 1990. Amen. Private Union Carbide Safety and Economic Consultant to Bhopal, India. And most recently, he's been on sabbatical as the U.S. Ambassador at Large to Somalia. Good. His academic and professional accomplishments are just too numerous.
To elucidate here.
But I need to mention, it's also a world-class pianist. He played at Carnegie Hall, I might add, a Boston Marathon triathlete, and the founder and leading shaman priest of an ancient Celtic religious cult spreading rapidly in Newport, Rhode Island.
Amazing man.
It's with great pleasure that I introduce Professor Omni Bustis. Ladies and
Not here.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, the professor is probably outgrading FP papers right now. So what we'd like to do is let me please introduce Admiral Strouser, who's president of the Naval War College, and for fear of reprisal, we're not going to see any more than that. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Admiral Strouser. Well, Admiral, I'm really pleased that you could join us here tonight. I know you're real busy. You've got all those future admirals and majors who are soon to... I know you've been real busy, probably out running a lot.
Very busy.
Well, what brought you to the Naval War College here today?
Well, many people, Joni, think that in our busy schedule here at the War College that we really never have time to come down on the Tonight Show. Well, nothing could be further from the truth. We're very happy to be here tonight.
Well, Admiral, I understand that you gave out some awards tonight. or earlier today. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct, Joni. Every year we have an award to present that exemplifies everything expected of a student out of the War College. Now, many people want to know how I can remember how to keep all these awards together, and of course it's in my photographic memory. This student epitomizes all things to all people. It's not only the most military student, it's the most serious student, a student who is extremely devoted to duty, a student who you can find at Zero Dark 30 in the weight room pumping iron, a student who refuses to allow a sink to pass through the auditorium without introducing himself and asking appropriate questions, a student who this year is not only the model student, but is also a model Marine. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in a warm applause for Lieutenant Colonel Richard E. Model, United States Marine Corps.
Well, that's great, Admiral. I really appreciate model Marines. In fact, I think E.D. was a Marine once. So I understand you have a clip about the good colonel.
Yes, that's true, Joni. We do have a clip tonight. I should mention that this clip came from the Marine Corps historical file. You'll notice that Lieutenant Colonel Model was then young Captain Model, sporting a mustache and an alias to protect himself from the former Abu Nidal and the boys. Let's sit back and take a look.
Thursday at noon.
I'm Jerome, United States Marine Corps. And you are my prisoner, sir.
You are a very dangerous man, Captain. And your President Roosevelt is mad.
Yes, sir.
A sweet warm hand, please, ladies and gentlemen. Serious back then, but no less dangerous.
Well, Admiral, it's some real impressive diplomacy, all right, and young Captain Model wasn't too bad himself. I'm glad we got the chance to recognize him tonight at the Naval War College as the Students of the Year. Actually, it kind of reminded me of the juniors trying to get their DA final this week.
Well, let's see. I understand that, just keeping in the spirit, we've got a public announcement. Is that correct, Admiral?
Public service announcement, very important, Joni. I think we should pay attention to this one.
Well, let's run that PSA.
Good morning. I'm Admiral Joe Strouder. I'm president of the United States Naval War College. You know, there are a lot of people that think that in our busy schedule at the War College, we never have time for a cup of coffee. Well, nothing could be further from the truth. As a matter of fact, every day I start my day with a great cup of coffee that Barbara fixes for me. Is the coffee ready, honey? As a matter of fact, every day I start my day with a great cup of coffee that Barbara fixes for me. And when she pours it for me, she always says,
"Put a lid on it, honey."
And so I do. Now, if you'll notice in the Hewitt lobby there, the carpet that they just replaced looks just like the carpet they replaced it with. I think that's a pretty good thing to the faculty and staff around our building in observance of such a good policy. So when you get up in the morning and you have yourself a cup of coffee, do as Barbara and I do. Put a lid on it.
Okay. Thank you. I guess we have a little bit of time left for some questions before we break. I know we always have some questions. We always have questions. While you're thinking about your questions, I should mention that I used to go to this War College too, and I used to sit right there in the front row, right there. And I had questions, but I was kind of afraid to ask them, so I'd keep them to myself. I'd go home, and I talked to Barbara about this, and Barbara told me that the only dumb question was a question not asked. So I thought I'd share that with
you
tonight.
Excuse me, Admiral, I think we have a question back here.
Oh, well, why, I certainly do. Yes, I see you, Admiral Strouser. Admiral Strouser, go ahead.
Admiral Strouser, if I may, I'd like to take advantage of asking the last question myself.
That's fine.
Barbara told me that the only dumb question was the question not asked. And so
I told you.
I thought about this question, decided not to ask it, but then found out it really would be a dumb question. So I think what I'll do is go ahead and ask you. What I'd really like to ask myself is, how did I really get this black eye?
Oh. Well, I take back everything I said about that dumb question. And if there are no further questions, I want to thank you very much for having us tonight. Thank you, Joni.
Well, thank you very much, Admiral. Ladies and gentlemen, please stick around for Admiral Strouder. Well, and no evening is not complete with a little announcement, and we have Mrs. Muffin Monday, spokesman for the Newport Naval Officers' Wives. Ladies and gentlemen, please join Mrs. Monday.
Hi, I'm Beer, Big Muffin Monday. I want to take this opportunity to talk to all you lonely wives of these geeky type A Naval War College types. It can be a pretty lonely year up here, we know. That's why we now have Muffin Monday. Every week, every Monday, from 8 o'clock to 4 o'clock at the Newport Officers' Wives Club, we girls get together and just share ourselves, our very souls, over coffee, tea, milk, vodka shooters, C-52s, scotch, and of course, muffins galore by yours truly, Big Muffin. So, you ladies, mark your calendars and come join us for free-spirited fellowship, groupie behaviorism, and of course, some great BM, Big Muffin, time. Thank you, Joanne.
Thank you, Mr. Lundy. He's here? Well, ladies and gentlemen, please join our special guest, Professor Omnibustus. He's here, yes! Ladies and gentlemen, bigger hands here, please, huh? How about it, huh?
I'm so sorry that I'm late. I'm frankly, I'm really embarrassed. You know, I don't have an aide de camp like the good admiral, and it's very difficult to keep my schedule. I mean, really, Joni, you'd have to live my schedule to believe it. Sit down, please. I can't stay. I just need to say a few things because I really feel like a dummy. I mean, but my schedule's unbelievable, and the thing is that there's a lot of academic interference in my schedule. I mean. This whole week I've been just bogged down. I just finished grading fourth planning finals. Prior to that, I had 15, 16 fourth planning papers. It was 35 or 40 elective papers. I mean, well, I read them quickly. These things are totally interfering with my primary duties. As you know, I'm on the board of directors of the Newport Tennis Association. I'm also the admiral of the Newport Yacht Club. I've just been elected president of the Newport Striders Running Club. I mean, this academic stuff is really interfering, and frankly, I'd like to stay. I'm late, and really, you may not know this, but I've been asked to address the Los Angeles Police Department on a fascinating new subject that we're looking at now. It's force planning considerations. For police departments. Most specifically, Daryl Gates has asked me to speak to the issue of protection for truck drivers during riots and such, and also future riot control forces in cities and urban areas. So really, I'd like to stay and speak with the audience, but looking out there, I noticed that it seems to be quite a military crowd, and I really don't think that they would appreciate or really understand what I would have to offer. So, Joni, I'm very sorry again. I must leave. I've got to go. Thank you very much. Thanks, folks.
Well, Jing Man, some music, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much.
That's all, folks.
You know, Miriam, listening to Karnak talk about total quality leadership reminded me of the fledgling effort that started here at the War College. You know, they've really jumped into this TQL with both feet. For the first project, they decided to take on the letting of the contract for mowing the lawns of the vacant houses and housing. They really got into that. They put a process action team together. They looked at the process. They looked at the customer's needs. They really got into that. They finally came to a decision to issue the contract to Joe Podolak's Hay Baling and Hauling Service, an upstart company in Nebraska. It's working out great, though, because the way it works is Joe waits until the neighbors, the residents in the housing area, get sick and tired of living next to a jungle. Then they go out and mow the lawn. The next day, Joe shows up with his truck. They bale the hay up, take it back to Nebraska, sell it to a farmer. It's recycling. It's TQL. I mean, it's really quite a process.
Yeah, we're into that TQL. It's kind of become one of our guiding principles. You could almost say that it's Navy doctrine. You know, we've got one group of students here that actually look at home in their civilian clothes. You know, no core fam shoes with their suits, probably because they are civilians.
No, that's true. I hadn't forgot about them. In fact, I think we might see them later this evening.
I think it's just about time to find out what they really have learned at the Naval
War
College.
We'll see what's up next.
The civilian students at the Naval War College are a distinct minority. On the whole, we arrived in Newport unfamiliar with military staff concepts and the subtleties of operational art.
Yet, our integration into every class and event, with the possible exception of your analysis and PT test, has provided us a unique opportunity both to learn old and new paradigms, and more importantly, to closely observe this community of warriors.
Not unlike Alexis de Tocqueville, the 19th century Frenchman who wrote on his impressions of Americans, or anthropologist Margaret Mead, or perhaps, more aptly, Diane Fossey or Jane Goodall, we felt compelled to document our findings.
Now, as the year has reached its culminating point, as our fellows progress toward receiving their degree, a coveted JPME qualification, and positions of higher authority among their predecessors in Washington and elsewhere, we would like to take this opportunity to share with you just a brief recorded segment on what we have observed around us on the issue of jointness.
We think it will speak for itself. Thank you.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, the jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a
joint man.
Roll right into town and be just like the other men. I'm tired of walking around. Oh, ooby-doo. I want to be like you. I want to walk like you. Talk like you. You see, it's true. And they like me. Can't learn to be human too.
Up and Roni. Have to be good lads of that and Roan. And you may be that. Loop, dabba, do the day, loop, up the root, the day, the bones, the bop, bop, bobby.
Abba, do thee.
Will a reap another.
Ever, dabba, doy.
Will a la, bazi, nee.
Well, a but, will a but.
Steeple, that, do thee.
Ooh, 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 ooh.
La, ha, 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 ha. Get mad, baby.
Ha, la, la, la.
Will a hot, la, da, la, do thee.
Oh, no, do thee.
Since we're going to take a 15-minute intermission here, there's champagne and Strasse's outside the auditorium. But remember, we want to keep those carpets clean, so put a lid on it.
And also, I overheard a conversation back here in the back. A man and his wife were talking. They were talking about possibly not coming back for the second half.
Oh,
let
no.
me tell you, that would be a major mistake. It's a multimedia dance song, and the NCC has a special program. So I recommend you come back.
I'm a new girl.
Test, 1, 2. Testing. It's been a great year for memories, Miriam. I can remember back. It was good. It was quite a treat. I remember as we walked up the big house and went in, it was quite a reception. And the Admiral likes to tell this story. I guess it's kind of a tradition. He tells a story when he was a student here. As he and Mrs. Strasser walked up the steps to the big house, she remarked how, wouldn't it be a great wonder if in some time they could have the opportunity to live in a house like that? And he told that story, and I looked at my wife, and I thought, well, that's very similar to our first impression as we walked up to our house in Coddington Cove. As we struggled through the waist-high grass and pushed aside the pile of paint chips to get the door open, my wife looked at me and said, you've got to be kidding me. Well, what's up next?
Well, up next we've got the Marines from the College of Naval Warfare.
Yes, sir, ma'am.
reputation is so tremendous. I'm going to have a great time there. I'm going to learn a lot. It's going to be a fun time for me, my family, and for the rest of the students here. Ma'am, you have a good day.
You're Turcotte, right? Who are the rest of these people?
Yes, Admiral, I'm Professor Turcotte. We're missing the head of the operations department down there in the end. He's been lost for as long as I've known him. You're right there is the Dean of Academics. And here on the left is... Here on your left is the illustrious head of the Strategy and Policy Department, Professor Bill Fuller.
Fuller, why don't you stand up when you're interviewed?
Admiral, I am standing.
All right, this meeting will come to order. Why are we having this meeting anyway?
Well, we're not really sure, but I guess it has something to do with a curriculum review. I don't know why we need a curriculum review. We've got an X in the block. We've had sexual harassment lectures.
Well, just mollify the students. Good.
Seems like a little bit of a waste of time to me.
Yeah.
I protest. Sir, I'm Professor Holman, your Russian expert. You can't change the curriculum. I've worked so hard. All my life, I've worked on the Soviet Union looking into the bear. Now you want to change the curriculum. I've got a book ready to be published, to be read by the students next year. All 4,000 pages of it. And you want to change the curriculum. Sir, if you insist on changing the curriculum, I demand to be moved to the Department of Operations, where nothing ever changes. Now, hey, security, security.
Admiral?
Sergeant Sixpack, security guard extraordinaire. Holds the NETC record for most jogger citations and most student vehicles towed for illegal parking.
Well, thank you, Admiral. Speaking of running, sir, as long as I'm here, I might as well give you the citation. It's a Delta Sierra violation, sir, for in reference to while running, tripping in traffic and falling on your face. Oh, and remember, sir, throw off the gum before you start running.
That was good.
Lieutenant Colonel Gregory Springbutt Border, voted most quiet, least likely to succeed by his class at Marquette. Now talks too much in two languages. Graduate of the Norwegian Defense College.
I'm here to complain about the grade system, Admiral. I have a 94.374186 grade point average. Unfortunately, this places me 198 out of 200 students here. If I can get 0.0371 increase or just extra credit in my grade, I move into the top 20% and I get one of the whoppers. And evidence for my I want to kind of demonstrate what I've done here to maybe get some extra credit. Well, I've taken both Professor Handel elective seances with Clausewitz. I've taken Professor Lee's seances with Corbett. The next thing is, since I've been here to this academic thing, I've been here appearing 17 times previously. Unfortunately, on my last office paper, I got an A+. I looked in the book, and I see that I can get at least 100. So I'd like to petition for 2 extra points that would maybe make a difference in my grade. And finally, Admiral, the probably the biggest thing. I've asked as many questions as John Brown in the auditorium during the
Okay, how about if we give you the same grade as Colonel Brown?
Lieutenant Colonel John Brown, U.S. Army, Ph.D. West Point, class of 71, armor officer, Ph.D. Graduate of the Army General Command and Staff College, history instructor, Ph.D.
Better for flirting, Indian. Character.
Lieutenant Colonel Steve Anderson.
You know how this college is about personal problems.
Voted Mr. Congeniality by the senior class.
Admiral, our complaint is about the S&P critique. They're giving it to us. They're giving to us too late in the curriculum to put good comments on them. Not enough room in the margins for appropriate comments, extra comments. What's more, no one really cares. All the lecturers are at least 4 years old.
I disagree. I've taken care of two of those problems already. Lectures are already done, and here they are. Lots of room to write.
Yeah, we can critique. Who was that? What are you critiquing for?
Colonel Select. Colonel Select Al Kellett, combat lawyer, scout sniper instructor, LLB, not PhD, but close.
You know, I'll bet he did all the reading.
I bet he did, too.
Hey, you do all the reading?
Oh, huh?
For just the right ones, baby.
Boy, that was good. I tell you what.
That's good.
You did all the reading.
Yeah.
You did them all.
Good man.
He don't read.
Really is.
Uh-oh. Who are you?
Who am I? I am Professor David Kaiser. I have written more books than most of the people in this institution have read. Thank you, Mr. Struber. Phil, really, are you reading The Prince again?
What? Yes, I am.
Oh, spare me.
What happened to your arm?
What happened to my arm? Perhaps it looks to you like a soccer injury. I was in the lavatory combing my hair when this giant, barrel-chested, corpulent, pro-football-playing, jarhead, cretin creep with the asinine appellation of Maccabin swings around from the urinal and hits me with what I thought at the time was a large club. Separates my shoulder. So, I run out of the bathroom and I run into one idiot from ops by the name of Paul Nell. Former caddy, grins like Red Skeleton, shaves with his sand wedge, and he slaps me on my bad shoulder and he says, "Dave, great day to hit the links, eh?" No one calls me David. No one. Bill, it is getting so bad, Bill, that I'm having a recurring dream that I get married to a member of the S&P staff. She bears me a son, Bill, and we name him Kilroy Milroy Kaiser. He's an insomniac. His hair is kind of wild. He has large, dark circles under his eyes. but he has a large forehead and a magnificent brain, Bill, a magnificent brain. Anyway, it was a dream. And the reason I'm here is to tell you that I have been offered and I have the opportunity to teach at the University of Bosnia-Herzegovina. And I am going there. I'm telling you, Struber, I'm going there, and I may never come back.
Good riddance. Good riddance.
Who was that again?
Who was that?
That was one of S&P's.
S&P?
Oh, yeah.
Sir, Lieutenant Colonel Model, United States Marine Corps.
Lieutenant Colonel. 6'3" tall, 180 pounds, 44-inch chest, size 2 hat band. Nice bun.
Nice bun.
Sir. The reason why I'm here is to address an issue of utmost concern, the behavior of students during lectures in Spruance Auditorium. There's entirely too much frivolity. On many occasions, there's also insubordination. The background conversations are often so loud that the speaker cannot even be heard. Many students daydream, and some even sleep. If students were required to sit at the position of attention, perhaps their attitudes would improve. If TQL renders this an inappropriate alternative, perhaps an etiquette award could be given to inspire proper student decorum.
You know, sitting attention, I like that. Makes you look taller. You know, I think Halsey would like it too.
Well, maybe Halsey'd like it, but Nimitz thinks it's too severe.
Forget about Halsey and Nimitz. What would Sam Nunn say?
What's Sam Nunn got to do with it?
Well, now that we're in a joint environment, we must be concerned with Goldwater Nickel.
Well, Sam Nunn didn't write Goldwater Nickel. That was named after the Senate and the House sponsors. You're a faculty member. Don't you know it was written by Teddy Kennedy and Jerry Studs?
Ted Kennedy and Jerry Studs? I thought Anita Hill wrote that.
No. Anita Hill gave our lecture on sexual harassment. She wasn't even elected in 1986. Lieutenant Colonel Model, you're dismissed.
Aye, aye, sir.
Hey, you know, Bill, the Admiral's right.
He does have nice buns.
Yeah.
Good fun.
Admiral!
Jock Strapp. And then an athletic scholarship to the Naval Academy to go to Mary Washington. 18-year Marine.
Sir.
Mental defective.
Sir. No, excuse me, that was Laurie's lunch. Sir, I came here a lean, mean Marine. Looking forward to some mind expanding drugs, academics to broaden and expand myself. I was looking forward to some quality time with my family. And I'm a decisive son of a bitch, that's for sure, but. The other thing I was looking forward to was some esprit with my fellow warriors from the other services. God, that was good. Bev, did we have bologna for dinner? But here I stand, everyone, with nothing more than an expanded ass, a broadened gut, a family that thinks they got a computer geek for a husband and a father, a master's degree that brings laughter from the boys down home, and a mind so cluttered with indecisive Clausewian thoughts that I don't know whether it was a good idea badly executed or a bad idea well executed. Did I like Professor Fuller, that little Danny DeVito short shit?
Nardo, get in
there.
I
have to say everything twice to know what I said, But I'll tell you this, Admiral. Excuse me. This I do know. A happy mind, it be a learning mind.
My grandpappy told me that. And we need more than this here stuff that's just mandated fun shit, you know? So we need an athletic program. A happy mind is a learning mind. Let's have some athletics at this school.
No.
Not a good
idea.
Athletic.
Yeah, let's keep having academics.
Academic.
Hey,
not a good idea.
Admiral, we need to move along here. Paul and Ellen and I want to play golf in about an hour.
Oh, okay. Any final comments?
Yeah. Reading what's successful? What's successful? We whipped him. It's like Sun Tzu with all those smells and stuff. You know, we've taken 14 wars and 7 teams. We've confused them so much, they can't possibly second grade success. We have succeeded.
We don't need critiques.
That's right.
We already have the finest minds at this higher institution of education. Besides, what can students contribute anyway?
No.
Let's get a bronze statue of Rich Model and give it as an etiquette award.
I disagree. We should make the statue of Art Etkin save many rubles. Many rubles.
Good idea.
For those of us Marines here at the College of Naval Knowledge who cherish our relationship with good old Firma Terra and our beloved Corps, studies of the naval and joint culture have come to us with great difficulty. We've had to suffer the pains of learning a new language with blue and purple overtones. Terms such as schlock, not to be confused with a lady of questionable reputation, by the way. Paradigms, not to be confused with 20 cents. MPAs, not to be confused with maritime public accountants, and tailhook, not to be confused with a trailer hook. And coincidentally, I understand, also not to be mentioned in polite company. There's a new acronym that's hit the field lately. It's known as SERB. And that, of course, is not to be confused with a nationality over in Yugoslavia. What we are talking about is the Selective Early Retirement Board. We all loathe the thought of that. But, you know, you've got to think about SERB positively. Look at it as being deep selected for early retirement. Now, we've also acquired a new set of heroes here at the War College. First, there was Mahan, who wanted to own the ocean. Then there was Corbett, who only wanted to control the ocean. Then there was Napoleon, who didn't understand the ocean. And then there was Bismarck. He didn't want any ocean. And then there was Clausewitz, who never saw any ocean. And then there was Sun Tzu, who would deceive you about oceans. And of course, then there was Mao Zedong, who was only concerned with the fish in the ocean. Also, we come to term with a whole new set of strategies and tactics, which took us over a year to sink in our thick skulls, and which can only be condensed into this one concept. When in doubt, protect the carrier. Ladies and gentlemen, we would remind you that part of the naval service is green. Our feelings can best be expressed in this song.
Well, I am, for one thing. You see, frogs are green, and I'm a frog, and that means I'm green, you see? It's not that easy being green. Having to spend each day the color of the leaves, when I think it could be nicer being red or yellow or gold, or something much more colorful like that. It's not easy being green. It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things, and people tend to pass you over because you're not standing out like flashy sparkles in the water or stars in the sky. green is all there is to be. It could make you wonder why, but why wonder why, wonder I am green, and it'll do fine. It's beautiful, and I think it's what I want to be.
Yes, ma'am, that was me.
Well, was the school everything was cracked up to be? But
well,
before you answer, Sonny, I want to tell you about me. I bet you'd never believe I, too, was a distinguished graduate of this institution's higher learning in 1986. And do you know what happened to me? They sent me out on a joint job, and I performed that job beautifully. And do you know what the Navy did to reward me for? They ripped me. I was the victim of a surge just 2 years later. Now, that's my warning you, boy. You got to be careful out there.
Well, ma'am, now I'm a joint warrior, and I'm ready to go down to Washington, D.C. in a purple suited job, and I've got my books, I've got my pen, I've got my glasses, I'm ready for anything.
I believe you, Sonny, I believe you.
The Naval War College, ma'am, it's not just a job, it's an adventure.
We need to take those guys off the steroids, you know. It sure has been a great year as you look back across the many events. Remember the in-doc lecture that we received when we first arrived?
Oh, yeah.
That was a real interesting time. They told us that it would be a challenging, invigorating, and rigorous academic year, but not to forget that it's also a time to spend time with your family and look at the beautiful Northeast, the historic Northeast, recharge your batteries. Well, I know I'm not the brightest guy on campus, but I've been so busy that about the only time I can see where I could recharge my battery is next week when I skip the current strategy forum. Just kidding.
No. Don't be cutting out on current.
What's up next, Miriam?
Well, up next we've got the Naval Command College. Students of the Naval Command College have spent quite a bit of our academic year doing some arduous PAD in the most distasteful places you can possibly imagine within the United States. But they've also managed to glean a couple of good classroom lessons, and they're going to present those in NCC News.
Good evening. This is the NCC News, and I am Nick Harris, standing in for Lynn Russell, who was standing in for somebody else.
Speak up!
It has been reported from Newport, Rhode Island, that a Naval War College technical study group has completed a study to find the simplest and most efficient way. Did I hear? Well, very well. In that case, for the faculty. It has been reported from Newport, Rhode Island. That a Naval War College study group has completed a study to find the simplest and most efficient way to empty the numerous ashtrays found on board ship. The report concluded that in order to reduce the time taken to empty any single ashtray, it has recommended that ship be turned upside down and shaken. Members of the Naval Command College were interested at the news that broke during the course that the U.S. Navy was being accused of losing a stealth freighter. On its way to Iran from North Korea and apparently carrying Scud missiles, the NCC decided to investigate a little more deeply from its privileged position and quiz senior service representatives. The Navy said it wasn't their fault because they needed 15 carrier battle groups for the task. The Air Force, however, said they could have tracked it easily with 50 B-2s. With the Air Force for 1 minute, a further update on the B-2 buy was reported today. The U.S. Air Force is now demanding at least 50 B-2s, up from the previous bid of only 20. And an Air Force spokesman said that the reason for this change was so that one could be home base in every state. And now, it's time for a word from our sponsors. Before moving on to our first live report tonight, we have had an update from the Western Desert in 1942 to where Prime Minister Winston Churchill has traveled in order to be briefed by General Bernard Montgomery on the progress of the campaign.
I say, flags, where the dickens is the Prime Minister? I'm here on a most pressing matter. Matters of state and all that. Now go on and get him.
I'm afraid Prime Minister is in bedroom by now, but I'm sure he won't be long.
That, I say, is really jolly. What? The bathroom? And here I have a war to fight? I will not be waited upon by some politician sitting in a bathroom. Now go, flag, go and get him.
Yes, sir. Prime Minister, General Montgomery is here now to see you, and he's becoming most impatient.
Tell Montgomery, I can only deal with one shit at a time.
has not escaped the notice of the NCC amidst whining, dining, traveling, and generally infuriating our War College classmates, who, for some inexplicable reason, seem so hung up on examinations, that there is some sort, we believe, of leadership campaign going on, and on, and on. Our simple tribute to this event is portrayed in this live news item, in which our intrepid reporter has caught up with one of the front-running prospective candidates, Mr. Bill Blinton.
How healthy I am, and young.
Good evening, Mr. Blinton.
Good evening.
How are you? Okay, we are going to know that you will answer what you want and not what we want to hear. But the American public wants to know one of the most important candidates.
Hi, Dan, again. Hillary said I could be here tonight. But she told me, since I may have an allergic reaction, not to answer any questions about flowers.
I love very much your British sense of humor, Mr. Blinton. But our bulldozer team has recently uncovered some other incidents which put in doubt your moral character.
Well, that's hard to believe. But I assure you, I'm innocent. I didn't lay a hand on Murphy Brown.
No, Mr. Blinton, I'm not talking about Mr. Murphy Brown. We have evidence of sexual misconduct in your youth. It seems you expose yourself in public. You can see the evidence.
That must be a Republican. I haven't done anything like that since before I go on field to go to Vietnam.
One more joke, Mr. Blinton, and you will be contracted by the Russian circle. Very well. But we also have evidence you use expensive government transportation for a vacation trip to Atlantic City.
That trip was official business. Judge Thomas and I were asked to be the keynote speakers at the new Tailhook East. But I assure you, if elected, I will use only the most economic